Hi, I'm Tamara Munzner, and now let's talk about analysis using the nested model of visualization. So I find it useful to have an analysis framework to think about visualization that's got four levels and three questions. So let's start with the top level, the domain level, what I'll call the domain situation. And this is where we ask the question of who are the target users that we might be designing a visualization for? What particular problems do they have? What data do they have? What questions are they asking about that data? What specialized knowledge do they have? So, you know, this could be someone in finance, it could be someone in physics, it could be someone in biology. They might have very different language for talking about what might at the core be really very similar problems from an abstract visualization point of view. And that's where we get to the next level, the abstraction level. What we want to do is think about the visualization issues in a way that's agnostic to the domain. So we want a sort of generic vocabulary of visualization. And so at the abstraction level, there's two main things we think about. What is being shown, so the data abstraction, and why is the target user looking at it, the task abstraction. And we might find that two people from, say, physics and finance are really, in fact, doing something really structurally very similar, but maybe two biologists sitting next to each other in the same lab are actually doing very different things, even though they're using some similar language to talk about them. So we really need this abstraction level to be able to reason about things in a domain independent way. Now the next level, the idiom level, we're asking how is it shown? And I'll split that again into the visual encoding idiom, how do we draw it? And the interaction idiom, how do we interactively manipulate that drawing? And so sometimes things are clearly one or the other. It's certainly possible to have idioms that really are inextricably combined of encoding with interaction, but sometimes it's useful to separate them. So that gives us the what and the why and the how. And then finally, we have this last level, the algorithm level. How do we efficiently actually compute this and instantiate it in a computational context? Now, the reason that we are thinking about this four different levels separately in this thing I've called the nested model is, for one thing, I want to emphasize something, that downstream we have this cascading effects. What you think about the domain user affects your abstraction, affects your idiom choice, and then, of course, your algorithm is trying to instantiate that. So there is this cascade. I also want to emphasize that it's very, very uncommon that you simply blast through and do this once and you're done with it. The common case is that you're iteratively refining. So as you start to try out some of these ideas, maybe even after you implement them, then you go up and change your understanding of what the user needs or what an appropriate abstraction is, and maybe you change the idiom. So there is cascading downward effects of decisions, but it's also very common to iterate back upward. So what's the value of these four levels, particularly for validating, did you get it right? Is there are fundamentally different ways to get it wrong at each of these levels. So what about the domain situation? Well, maybe you misunderstand the needs of a particular person. Did you talk to them? Did you watch them? Turns out what people do and what they say they do can be quite different. And then at the abstraction level, well, maybe you've made the wrong choices of abstraction. One of the interestingly tricky things about visualization is you don't always get to just draw the data you're given. Sometimes you need to transform it into some other set of attributes so that when you draw that, it actually helps them. So there's often a lot of choices in the data abstraction. If you get those choices wrong, then the best visual encoding in the world can't save you. What about at the idiom level? Well, maybe what you had in mind to encode the data versus what the user's eyes actually decode, maybe those don't match up. The human perceptual system is quite a tricky beast. It has a lot of complexities for the unwary. So you don't always have people decoding what you thought you've encoded. And then finally, at the algorithm level, well, computationally, maybe you have a ridiculously slow algorithm, and maybe in fact you can't do what you need. For example, make it respond immediately when the user moves the mouse. So these are four really different threats to validity at each of these levels. So the solution is we need to be interdisciplinary and have a grab bag of methods. We need to pick methods from different fields at each one of these levels. At the algorithm level, one way we can check things is, well, we can certainly do computational benchmarks to measure system time and memory. For the more theoretically inclined among us, we could analyze computational complexity. So these methods are well taught in a traditional computer science department. A huge amount of the work in visualization is exactly doing this. I'm going to call that technique-driven work. So there's quite a lot of work in Viz at the algorithm level, where you understand completely the context and you're just focusing on that algorithmic troubles. But what about the other levels? Well, let's think about the idiom level. So first of all, even before we implement anything or design algorithms, we might want to think about, well, what are the alternatives for idioms? We often grab methods out of design, especially the idea of the ideation of multiple alternatives instead of just latching onto one idea and then never diverging from it. But what about after we've actually got something instantiated? How would we figure out if we got the idiom level right? Well, we grab methods out of cognitive psychology, often by way of human-computer interaction. And of course, we could just simply look at the results and analyze them qualitatively. But if we want to do something a bit more rigorous, we would often do a controlled experiment in a lab. Sometimes this is called a lab study or a user study, where instead of measuring how long it takes the computer to compute something, we've got our stopwatch and we're measuring people. We tell them, please do this using this particular tool. And we see how long it takes. We see how many mistakes they make. And so, of course, the methodology of running controlled experiments on human subjects is quite tricky, and there's a lot of nuances to get right. But we're not done yet. What about that abstraction and domain level? Well, here's where we need to get methods out of the social sciences, from anthropology and ethnography, where actually observing people in a particular realistic context, that's, again, tricky. There's a lot of nuances about how to elicit information about what they're currently doing. Talking to them is necessary, but not sufficient. And so then that's, you know, before designing, we might want to make sure to talk to them. And after we've designed something, instead of just looking at it in a laboratory context, maybe we need to deploy that tool and watch how people actually use it in realistic settings, not just in your own lab. And so we typically call that a field study. It still involves human subjects, but we're actually deploying it and watching how it gets used. And it's almost inevitable that it's not used in quite the way you originally had in mind. People are very good at making tools out of anything and adapting their tools to different use cases. And of course, we could also do things like measure how many people use it. Adoption is an interesting signal. A lack of adoption doesn't mean that you misdesigned it. And in fact, you could have heavily adopted things that might not be the best, but it is a signal about whether it's actually meeting real world needs. So these are all different ways to try to understand, did your solution work? So when we start at that top level from the domain situation and work our way all the way down, where we work with a group of target users and try to figure out the abstractions and then the idioms and then instantiate those computationally, we're often calling that problem-driven work. And the buzzword in the Viz community for that is a design study. So these are both major approaches to go on, but the nested model is really trying to get you to think about these levels, either from problem-driven work or just for technique-driven work, to think about, for some algorithm, which idioms is it actually trying to instantiate. A key thing, avoid mismatches. So if you want to convince me that your new idiom works well with the human perceptual system, you can't do that telling me how fast it took to compute each frame. That's relevant for the algorithm level, but it doesn't provide validation for the idiom level. Another example, if you want to understand if you got your abstractions right, do people really do what you think they do? You can't bring them into your lab and tell them what to do. You have to actually go and deploy it in more realistic contexts in the field. So be aware that it can be really difficult to validate task abstractions through controlled experiments in the lab.